We are not afraid to die if we all can be together. So here is a chapter which we started off yesterday. So what we had read out, like the narrator Gordon Cook, he decides to go in for a voyage. Voyage is a long journey by sea. So he actually wants to do the same thing what Captain James Cook had done about 200 years ago. So Captain James Cook might have been his inspiration to undertake this kind of adventurous voyage. And he does it. And before he goes for this kind of voyage, he makes preparation for about 16 years. He and his wife, Mary, they spent a lot more of their leisure time in honing, that is sharpening their seafaring skills. What are seafaring skills? The skills which one needs in the sea. When one is undertaking a voyage in the sea, then one needs to know so many skills which he might use during that voyage or that journey by sea. So in that journey, you know, in this voyage, his own children, his own son who is 6 years old, Jonathan, and his daughter Suzanne, who is 7 years old, they were with him. So the setting of the scene, the setting of the story takes place in July 1976, when they set off for this kind of adventurous journey. So they set sail from Plymouth, England. So they started from England, and the first leg of the journey will be from England to South Africa, that is Cape Town. So the first leg of the journey, which would encompass about 105,000 kilometers. So basically they had planned that it would be a journey of 3 years. It would take about 3 years for them to cover up this voyage. The first leg of the journey, which would be from England to South Africa, that is Cape Town. That part of the journey, you know, it went off well. No problem came up. Okay, but the problems came up, the challenges came up when they started from Cape Town to eastwards. That is when they entered the South Indian Ocean. Then they started facing the real challenges of the sea. And it's not that that these challenges came up like out of the blues. They were prepared for it. Why were they prepared? How can we say that they knew that now they would be facing the challenges in the sea? What's the proof? There is a proof that they knew that there would be challenges, there would be difficulties in the South Indian Ocean. So how do we know this? Can anyone tell me? How did they know? What was the proof that they knew that there would be challenges in the South Indian Ocean? Yesterday we read it out. So what was the proof that they knew that there would be challenges in the South Indian Ocean? If you know, then you can raise hand. I can ask you to speak up then. I can unmute you then. So what was the proof that they knew that there would be problems in the South Indian Ocean? What was the proof of their knowledge? So Riddhi is telling us that it was the roughest sea in the world. Because it was the world's roughest, Japanjot, Samriddhi. Samriddhi, they began to encounter the strong gales when they started off in the south, in that sea. But my question is, like before they started the journey towards that South Indian Ocean, they knew this that it would be the roughest sea. Like, what's the proof that they knew this? Himanshu Dhir says that because the Indian Ocean is considered as the roughest ocean. So herein is my question. Like my question was, like, how did they know that it would be the roughest ocean in the world? Like, how do we know that they knew this? The point is, the answer is that they decided to hire two crewmen. When they reached South Africa in Cape Town, before they proceeded towards the South Indian Ocean, they hired two crewmen. One was a Swiss and another was an American. The American crewman, Larry Vigil, and Swiss was Herb Sigler. So they hired these two crewmen at South Africa at Cape Town because they knew that they were going to enter the roughest sea of the world. And in that sea, they might encounter challenges. And in order to safeguard themselves from those disasters, they were getting preparation. They were making preparations to save themselves from that kind of disaster. And one of those preparations was that they hired these two crewmen. Okay, so this was a timely decision. And the timely decision they were able to make out because they had the knowledge. And now the point comes up, like, why, what made them have this kind of knowledge? They had this kind of knowledge because they had prepared for this voyage for 16 long years. I always emphasize, whenever we do this chapter, I always emphasize upon the preparation part. It's not important like what you do. The more important thing is like how much preparation you do for that. Many people start off doing difficult things or various things. But the people, those who start with preparation, they only succeed. And the people, those who start off just to experience something, many a times they don't succeed. So the point is not only about starting. The point is also about, like, before starting, how much you prepare. So these people, they were preparing. So this narrator, Gordon Cook, with his wife, they spent 16 years in making preparation, right? Yes, Pragati says it was their meticulously laid out plans and preparations that allowed them to foresee upcoming situations. Yes, Pragati, this is what I wanted to listen basically. So it was their preparation, it was their planning which helped them foresee. So planning, preparation made them have knowledge. And it was the knowledge which made them foresee the events which might take place in the South Indian Ocean, right? So it's the knowledge which made them see that, yeah, it is going to be the roughest sea in the world. Right? So they hired two crewmen. One was an American, Larry Vigil, and another was Herb Sigler. And they hired these two crewmen at Cape Town. Right? And when did they reach Cape Town? When they had covered the first part of the journey. And the first part of the journey was from England, that is Plymouth, England, to South Africa. At South Africa, what was the exact place? Plymouth. So this was the first leg of the journey which went off well. And before they proceeded towards the South Indian Ocean, they had already hired these two crewmen so that they could prove to be of some help in the coming difficult days, right? So here, another important thing which we had read out yesterday, like 16 years they had prepared, they had made preparations to go for this kind of journey, for this kind of voyage. And along with the other preparations and along with, seeking knowledge about the whole thing, they also got a boat wave walker professionally built. Okay, the wave walker, it was a professionally built boat. It's not that they just went somewhere and they purchased a boat or they made it on their own. They got this boat, wave walker, professionally built. Okay, so what's the difference? So you are able to make out like professionally built boat. So it means that they didn't want to leave any chance. They didn't want to they didn't want to go in for a single chance, which might prove disastrous in the voyage. So the wave walker, it was a 23 meter and 30 ton wooden hulled beauty. So it was a wooden structure. It was a wooden structure which its dimensions were 23 meter and 30 ton weight. So such a huge structured, boat they had for this kind of purpose. So, okay, first part of their journey went off well, this which we had read out. On our second day out of Cape Town, we began to encounter strong gales. So hardly had they stepped out of Cape Town, hardly had they entered the south, that's east side, that they started facing strong winds. For the next few weeks, they blew continuously. So for weeks together, the winds kept on blowing, but gales did not worry me, but the size of the waves was alarming. So being a very knowledgeable, sailor, Gordon Cook, he knew that if these strong winds were blowing, they were not a matter of concern. But yes, if the waves were becoming larger if the waves were becoming alarming, so that was really very, very dangerous, or that is going to be a matter of concern for him. So the size of the waves was up to 15 meters. So the height of the wave, average height of the wave at that time was coming up to be 15 meters, and it was as high as our main mast. And the size of the wave was about 15 meters in height. And that size was equivalent to the main mast, the height of their main mast. What's the main mast, children? Mast is a pole in the ship, right? It's a pole in the ship from where the storm jibs are tied up. Okay, main sail this jib, or you can say storm jib and all, they are coming up in the next lines. So right now it's a pole in the boat. So December 25 found us 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. So on December 25, they had covered up 3,500 kilometers ahead of Cape Town. Despite atrocious weather, we had a wonderful holiday complete with a Christmas tree. So Christmas, they were able to enjoy Christmas holiday despite the fact like the atrocious, the unfavorable weather conditions were prevailing. New Year's Day saw no improvement in the weather, but we reasoned that it had to change soon, and it did change for the worse. So they were expecting like maybe the weather would become, weather would change by the time the new year would come. And yes, it changed, but it had changed for the worse. So the weather conditions had become quite more alarming by the time it came up to be the new year. At dawn on January 2, the waves were gigantic. So on 2nd Jan now, the waves became all the more alarming. They became all the more, larger or dangerous in size. We were sailing with only a small storm jib and still making 8 knots. So we were sailing with only a small storm jib. What's a storm jib? So with the mast to the forward side, to the front side, a storm jib is connected or it is tied up. Okay, so where I was, we were sailing with only a small storm jib and were still making 8 knots. So storm jib is a triangular mast, okay, triangular sail, which is tied up to the main mast of the ship. This triangular sail helps the sailors in the, when the winds are very fast or when there is storm in the ship, when there is storm in the sea. So in the stormy conditions, this jib helps the sailors. And they were still moving, they were still sailing with only a small storm jib and were still making 8 knots. Knot is a unit of, speed in the water. As the ship rose to the top of each wave, we could see endless enormous seas rolling towards us. As the ship rose to the top of each wave, so children, from here, you can imagine the condition of the sailors or the condition of the ship. So as the ship rose to the top of each wave, so now because the storm, the waves were rising up. So with each rise in the wave, their ship was also going up along with the wave. Got it? So whenever their ship would be going up with the wave, they could see the endless, enormous seas rolling towards us. So when they would go at the top of the wave, from the height, they would see the endless sea in front of them. So here there are two things, children. Number one, the critical conditions or the alarming conditions they were sailing right now. Now the ship was not sailing smoothly forward. Now the ship was rising up along with the wave. how critical the situation is. And secondly, when they were at the top of the wave, from there, they would try to see if the land is visible somewhere. Because they, when you are able to see some land around you in the sea, then you at least have a relief that yes, you are, you'll be able to reach the land very sooner. And this time would be, the danger will be over. But right now, they did not have any ray of hope, right? Sea was all around. All around there was water and water and water. As the ship rose to the top of each wave, this is a very important sentence, because from here we come to know the kind of strong, the kind of waves which were there at that time when they were in the midst of the sea. So whenever their ship would rise to the top of the wave, they could see the endless, enormous sea eroding towards us, and the screaming of the wind and spray was painful to the ear. So when their ship would go along with the wave at the top of the ocean, from there, they could, number one, the kind of, you know, disaster they could imagine. Along with that, they only were able to, number one, they were able to see only water all around. And secondly, they could only hear the spray of the water or of the wind. So painful noise created by the winds or of the spray of the water, that was all painful, because nothing was giving them a relief. And the screaming of the wind and the spray was painful to the ears. To slow the boat down, we dropped the stern jib and lashed a heavy mooring rope in a loop across the stern. Now the children, what was like happening? Strong winds were blowing. Secondly, the high waves were rising. So it was like if the waves were to continue like this, if the waves would continue to rise up like this, and would take the ship each time with them up, then there was the risk, like maybe their ship would get capsized. Maybe their ship would become upside down. So in order to, lessen the effects of the storm, they tried to decrease the speed, or they tried to reduce the speed of the boat. Okay, in order to safeguard themselves, or in order to safeguard the boat from drowning or saying, you know, capsizing, what steps did they take? Number one, they dropped the storm jib. The first of, whenever somebody is in the sea, maybe in the ship or boat, and when the storm comes up, the very first thing the sailors do is they reduce the speed of the ship or the boat. So now, The ship was moving at 8 knots already. Now they wanted to reduce its speed. So what they did to slow the boat down? Number one, they dropped the storm jib. So they dropped the storm jib and lashed means they tied a rope, and they lashed a heavy mooring rope in a loop across the stern. Stern is the back part of the ship. So what did they do to slow the boat? Number one, they dropped the storm jib. I already told you, like, storm jib is a triangular sail which is set forward the mast to make the boat move in a particular direction. But right now, when they wanted to slow the boat, they first of all dropped the storm jib so that the speed of the boat or ship would become less. First, they dropped the storm jib, and secondly, they tied a rope in a loop across the stern. They tied up a loop. They tied the back part of the ship with a rope. Why did they tie the back part of the ship with a rope? So that the speed of the ship would remain less. Then we double lashed everything. Lashed is like tying something with a rope. They tied up everything with a rope. Went through our life raft drill. Attached lifelines, donned oilskins and life jackets, and waited. What did they wait for? They started waiting for the disaster to happen. Isn't it very strange that they started waiting for the disaster? It is said like, if you want peace, be prepared for the war. You know, it said, if you want peace, then be prepared for the war. The meaning is that if you want peace in the end, then first be 100% ready to face the war. Be 100% ready to face the war means that your preparations should be complete. You must be like, your all armaments and ammunitions, they should be all stocked up well, so that in case somebody attack you, you are in a position to defend yourself. So once when you'll be able to defend yourself, when you'll be able to defeat your enemies, then in the end, the peace would prevail. Yes, don't go for the war, but yes, be ready for the war. Ready means be prepared. Keep your preparations complete. So right now, the point is, like, it's not like they were going to go for the war. Yes, they waited for the disaster, because they were waiting for the disaster doesn't mean that they wanted the storm to come and let the, their ship get capsized and they would be like drowning. So it's not like they waited, like they knew now, they knew that the disaster would come, because the waves were rising higher and higher with each wind. So now they knew that the disaster would come, but before the disaster comes, they were ready to face the disaster. How were they ready to face the disaster? Number one, they reduced the speed of the ship or the boat by dropping the storm chip. Number two, they tied up the back part of the ship with a rope. Third, they double lashed everything. They tied up everything in the ship with a rope, went through our life raft drill. So rafting, you must be knowing. Now they started doing the drill. They started doing the practice of rafting skills, life raft drill. So in case the boat would capsize, then where will the sailors go? They will go, they will do the rafting. The rafters and all were already attached lifelines. So when the sailors, when the ship is going to maybe the ship would just go upside down, okay? In that case, if the sailors are having the lifelines with them, lifelines are the ropes. The sailors attach themselves with the ropes. And each part and one end of the rope is attached with the boat and one end of the rope is attached with the sailor. So in case the boat would go upside down, then afterwards, if the boat or the ship becomes straight again, upright again, then the sailors are able to come back to their ship with the help of that lifeline. So they attached themselves with the lifelines, donned oilskins. They put on the oil on their bodies and life jackets, and they put on even the life jackets, right? So these were the things which they did before they got ready to face the disaster, waited for the disaster. So what's the significance of waited here? Waited is like now they were prepared to face the disaster thoroughly. So when you are prepared, then even you can come out of that disaster successfully. You can survive the disaster. Okay, this is what we are doing nowadays. Okay, nowadays in this pandemic, what we are doing? We are prepared. How are we prepared? We are working upon our immunity. We are working upon all the safety measures, right? And and the authorities, you know, they have also managed to make the system soundproof, so that in case there is an eventuality, the things would be managed so that the things are controlled. Okay, so waited is like be prepared, and preparation means that the things must be organized as per the requirement in the future. So on 2nd January, this paragraph, children, we are reading that on 2nd January, when the waves had become quite alarming in size, when with each wave, the ship was rising high, then these sailors were able to conclude that they did not have any respite in the near future. There was no land nearby. So the disaster might occur. So in order to save themselves from the disaster, the sailors, they did some things to safeguard themselves. Number one, they reduced the speed of the ship. How did they do this? By dropping the storm jib. Then they tied the back part of the ship with a rope. They tied everything of the ship with a rope. Then they did the drill of the life rafting. They attached lifelines with themselves. They put on oilskins and they put on life jackets. So these measures they adopted to safeguard themselves, save themselves from the impending disaster. So this is a very important question. Like, what happened on 2nd January? On 2nd January, they experienced strong gales and strong waves, high waves. But there was no hope of respite or relief in anywhere nearby or in near future. So in order to safeguard themselves, they prepared to face the disaster. Got it? And how? What preparations they made? These were there, which I have already spoken for two times or three times. So this is a very important question. You may note it down. Like, what preparations they made to safeguard themselves on 2nd January, right? The first indication, they waited for the disaster to happen. The first indication of impending disaster came about 6 p.m. The first indication of impending disaster came at about 6 p.m. with an ominous silence. What is ominous? Ominous is when something signals the evil, when something signals the bad. Okay, when you come to know that something bad is going to happen. Okay, so the first indication of the impending disaster came about 6 p.m. with an ominous silence. So all throughout the day, the spray or the wind, the noise was painful to the ears. Throughout the day, they kept on hearing painful spray or the noise of the wind. But at 6 p.m., there was pin drop silence. And that silence indicated the impending disaster. Okay, all of a sudden there was silence. So that silence meant that something wrong is going to happen. So that silence was the signal of an impending disaster. That silence was a signal that now the disaster is coming up. What happened? The wind dropped and the sky immediately grew dark. So all of a sudden, the wind stopped blowing and the sky became dark. Then came a growing roar and an enormous cloud tarred aft of the ship. So then what happened? Very important point here. So first there was silence, the wind stopped blowing and the sky became dark. Then came a growing roar and an enormous cloud tarred aft of the ship. So then with a growing roar, a cloud covered the ship. All of a sudden there was silence. Then there was a roar, and with that roar, with that blasting sound, you know, it appeared as if a cloud had covered the ship. Okay? It appeared as if a cloud had covered the whole ship. It appeared as if a cloud had made a canopy over the ship. With horror, I realized that it was not a cloud, but a wave like no other I had ever seen. So first it appeared that it was a cloud which had covered the whole ship. But then narrator Gordon Cook realized that, oh my God, that was not a cloud. That was a wave which had covered the ship. And it was a kind of wave which he had never ever seen earlier. It appeared perfectly vertical and almost twice the height of the other waves with a frightful breaking crest. So that wave was, number one, double the height of the other waves. Other waves were about 15 meters in height, you know, earlier we read out. Other waves, the size of the height of the other waves was usually 15 meters. And that size of the wave was almost equal to the mast of the ship. But now the size of the height of the wave was about, you can say, approximately 30 meters. It was like far, far more than what the height of their main mast was. And now, secondly, now the wave was, it's not that the ship was going up with a wave. Now the ship was down and the wave had covered it from above. And the wave was almost, so it appeared perfectly vertical and almost twice the height of the other waves with a frightening breaking crest. The roar increased to a thunder as the stern moved up the face of the wave. What's a stern? Stern is the back part of the ship. So now with the increasing roaring sound of the wave, now the roar became a thunder and the back part of the ship moved up the face of the wave. The back part of the ship, you know, it moved towards the face of the wave. You can imagine if the back part of the ship moves up, what is happening? It means that the front part of the ship is facing the water. I thought the roar increased to a thunder as the stern moved up the face of the wave, and for a moment I thought we might ride over it. But then a tremendous explosion shook the deck. What's a deck? Deck is the floor of the ship. So first there came a roar, and then the wave, you know, it was almost vertical over the ship. Then the roar transformed into a thunder, and with that thunderous sound, you know, the wave shook, it blasted, it exploded. The wave exploded. What is there in the wave? Wave is all water. So if that wave exploded, the water all fell upon the ship, and it almost exploded the deck. It almost exploded the floor of the ship. A torrent of green and white water broke over the ship, and my head smashed into the wheel, and I was aware of flying overboard and sinking below the waves. A torrent, so when that wave exploded, all water, green and all water fell upon the floor of the ship, the deck of the ship. So because there it was an explosion of water, so Gordon Cook's head almost, you know, it bumped into the wheel, so a torrent of green and white water broke over the ship. My head smashed into the wheel, and I was aware of flying overboard and sinking below the waves. So he knew that he was flying overboard and sinking below the waves. Gordon Cook, now he knew that he was flying overboard. I accepted my approaching death, and as I was losing consciousness, I felt quite peaceful. So then narrator was almost, you know, he was actually drowning. Okay. So at that time he was losing his consciousness, and in that unconscious state, in that semi-unconscious state, he was experiencing extreme pain. Sorry, peace. He was experiencing extreme peace. Pain is so far we are alive. After death, there is no pain. There is peace. There is silence. Okay? So silence or peace comes when death comes. Because death removes all pain and brings in all peace. So he felt that peace at that time. So it was actually the unconsciousness in which he was experiencing pain. Because when you are unconscious, you don't know what is happening around you. You don't know, you don't experience the pain, physical pain, okay? Unexpectedly, my head popped out of water a few meters away. So unexpectedly, he did not expect this because he was almost unconscious and he was feeling as if he had died, okay? But unexpectedly, he felt his head popped out of water a few meters away. A few meters away, Wave Walker was near capsizing. So he found himself a few meters away from the boat. Gordon Cook found himself a few meters away from the Wave Walker and saw that the Wave Walker was almost capsizing, her mast almost horizontal. Then a wave hurled her upright. So very soon, there and then, another wave came and made the ship upright. What happened? One wave made the boat capsize, made it go upside, made it, okay? And another wave came and made it upright. My lifeline jerked taut. So the lifelines with which the narrator was attached, so the moment the boat became upright, the lifelines with which he was attached, they also became tight. I grabbed the guardrails and sailed through the air into the Wave Walker's main boom. So this very narrator, with the help of the lifelines or the guardrails, he sailed through the air into the wave walker's main section, main boom, main section. Subsequent waves tossed me around the deck like a rag doll. What's a rag doll? Rag doll is a doll made up of cloth. Okay. So he came to the main section of the ship, and there he was thrown from one side of the boat to another as if he were a rag doll. So because so much water was there, because the wave had almost exploded on the deck of the water, on the ship. So in that water, he was being thrown by water from one side to another as if he were a rag doll. My left ribs cracked, my mouth filled with blood and broken teeth. So at that time, his condition was very critical. His left ribs cracked. His mouth started, bleeding. So my left ribs cracked, my mouth filled with blood and broken teeth. Somehow I found the wheel, lined up the stern for the next wave and hung on. So in that condition, when he had almost... when he almost